Thank you, Eric. I appreciate that. And I want to thank Darlene Randall McCoy for all her help in making arrangements to make my travel here fairly uneventful and comfortable. So I was here at the Farley Center many years ago when the pavilion was just starting construction. As a matter of fact, they were doing some foundation work. And I thought that it was going to be like a big old 4 or 5 story bricks and mortar square building. And I came back and saw this beautiful campus. How impressive. I mean, you guys need to appreciate, I guess, the fact that you work in such a beautiful place. How many people in here are social workers? How many counselors? Okay. Any psychologists? Any physicians? Okay. That kind of gives me a little idea about how to gear what I'm presenting today. I'm going to talk to you about sort of the third edition of motivational interviewing. How many people have had any instruction in motivational interviewing at all? Some not. How about stages of change? Is everybody here familiar with that? In the beginning of this, we're going to talk a little bit about stages of change to sort of use as a model to help demonstrate how motivational interviewing can be used to process people and move people through those stages. Trying to get the timing here. Let's look at your handouts, and you all should have something that looks like this. Actually, is a pre-post. Yes. It says Principles of Motivational Interviewing Pre-Post Quiz. If you look down toward the middle of the page, you'll see that it says Avoiding Triggering Resistance. Please mark out the word resistance and put the word discord, and that'll become apparent later on. And then you'll see about 3 spaces down where it says techniques to reduce resistance do the same thing. Put the word discord in. And take a minute or two, go through this, and mark where you see yourself fitting on this scale of awareness and knowledge regarding each of these concepts that are listed here. So we're going to do a pre, and then when we finish, post. And that brings me to a need that I have. I'd like to have a volunteer who's willing to remind me at the end of this that we're going to go through this and review this, because I've walked out of workshops before and forgotten to take people through the post test to see if there's any change in your information and knowledge level between pre and post. So just go ahead and do that, and when you're done, just look up. Looks like this. Everybody had a chance to get through that? Okay, thank you for letting me know. Do I have a volunteer who can remind me to review this at the end? Thank you. And since you're so nice to volunteer, I would also like you to play timekeeper and tell me when it's like 10:15, because that's when we're going to try and take our break. So I tend to get lost in the minutiae of what I'm doing and forget about the time factor sometimes. Also, when you get to be my age, sometimes our bladders will dictate when we take a break. So I've had some coffee this morning, so just be aware if I have to take a quick run. You'll understand, hopefully. Okay, here are the goals of today's training. Because this is a 2-hour presentation as opposed to a two to five-day presentation. We're not going to obviously get to all these things, but comprehensive training in motivational interviewing would incorporate understanding the underlying spirit and approach, and I do think that I can cover that fairly well today with you. And to recognize reflective listening responses and differentiate them from other counseling responses. In other words, being able to know when you're doing MI and when you're not. And by the way, once you get competent and experienced with this, you'll be able to slip in and out of MI as appropriate. You'll know when you're using it and when you're not, and it's not always appropriate. And it's very compatible with other approaches. To be able to provide 50% reflective listening responses during a conversation, it's like you want to ask, typically, you want to make two reflections for each question that you ask. I mean, that's just a rule of thumb. Obviously, we're not going to stick to that like it's engraved in granite. You do it according to what makes sense within a conversation with somebody. And really, motivational interviewing is a way of having a conversation. And to recognize change talk and to be able to differentiate commitment language from other types of change talk. As we go through this, you'll be able to identify different sort of magnitudes of change in terms of recognizing and paying attention to the kinds of words people use, and we're going to cover that later on. To listen, demonstrate several strategies for eliciting change talk. I'm hoping we'll get to that, but time will tell. Here are some of the ways in which people who commit themselves to learning and really getting some experience and skills regarding MI. You can take workshops like this, doing practice training, and extend that through in vivo application. You'll see MINT down here in that third grouping. That's Motivational Interviewing Network of Trainers, and I'm in that network. It's an international group of people who have had training either by Bill Miller or Stephen Rollnick, the two founders and creators of motivational interviewing, and then some other things that we had to do in terms of coaching. I've been through most of these things. So, stages of change. Before we do that, let's do one really quick exercise. Who's good about who has good penmanship and can make a list of things on this flip chart for me? Anyone good at doing that? Usually. Who is?
Me.
Well, come on down. So what we're going to do right now is something called agenda mapping. It's sort of a rough adapted version of that. We used to call it agenda setting, and the earlier editions of motivational interviewing text, but we now started using it as a map because a map is like you have a starting point and you have an end point, and sometimes during the process of going from one to the other, we find there can be detours, there can be barriers, and there are different paths to get to that end point. So agenda mapping, and it's simply a way to start the conversation, to engage someone, to develop rapport. So here's the question we'll start with today. What would you like to get from this presentation? And then what's your first name again?
Lois.
Lois is going to write down your responses. And so I either get volunteers or I start selecting people. What would you like to get from today's presentation? Okay, learn how to develop discrepancy. So you can just write develop discrepancy. Anyone else? Yes?
Basic overview.
Excellent. That's what this is going to be, by the way. It's an overview of MI and an update to the third edition, because things have changed a little bit since the first edition. My training happened in the mid-90s, and I worked with Bill Miller out in Albuquerque. And so that was under the first edition, and then I've done trainings under the second edition and now the third edition, which is here. By the way, these are not my books. I'm not selling anything, but these are resources, and you're welcome at the break or afterwards to come up and take a look at these. So I just want people to know what's available out there to further your own information and education about MI. Anybody else? What do you want to learn? How to respond to client comments. I hope we can get to that too. Yeah.
How to enhance the changes in the stages of change to get them to move to the next.
Okay. How to move people through SOC, stages of change. Any others?
Strengthen desire to change.
Strengthen desire.
Be motivation.
Well, desire is part of it. That's okay. Strengthen desire to change, because that's part of what we try to look for. It's part of darn cat. Has anybody ever heard darn cat in conjunction to MI? We're going to cover that today. Anything else? Thank you, Lois. That's good.
Sure.
I appreciate that. So what did I just do? I started talking to you all about what are your interests? What are your goals? And that's important with motivational interviewing, because we're here to serve our clients' needs, not our own. I'm not guaranteeing that we'll get through all this, but at least you had a chance to say, here's what I want. Here's what I want. And then we'll talk about how that works in the whole framework of motivational interviewing when we get through the section, this next section on stages of change, which is what we're doing now. If you remember stages of change, this is one way to think about it. You have pre-contemplation here, which means that people aren't thinking much about changing. I had a case of a school teacher who came in my office, and she was obviously frustrated and sat down. I said, what's going on? She said, well, my husband just made some comment about my weight, and I think he's full of crap, and I don't think I'm overweight, and blah, blah, blah. So she wasn't thinking about changing that. About a month later, she comes in, and she's short of breath. She just walked up the little short five steps into my office, and she was going, oh, my God, maybe he has a point. I'm out of breath just walking up those steps. And she says, my skirt's a little tighter than I realize. And so she moved from pre-contemplation, no problem, to, you know, maybe there's something going on here. And then you'll see that moves into preparation, where you may have a problem that you're beginning to recognize. And how many in substance abuse see this all the time, where the person that has the problem is sometimes the last one to know. And then you move into preparation, which means, you know, I may have a problem here, and I'm now aware of that, but I'm not sure what to do. What this lady did, to continue with that example, is she started reviewing different types of weight loss programs in our area. She wasn't sure whether she was going to join the Y or go to Pilates, or there was some other kind of organization that did a lot of physical exercise. And she eventually went to trying to think of the name of the program. Can't think of it right now. But anyway, they did exercise, and they talked about nutrition. And over the course of about 12 weeks, she lost 7 pounds and started to feel better. So she moved from no problem to maybe there is a problem to I'm not sure what to do about it, but she explored different options, made a plan, and then put that plan into action. Where a lot of people get hung up with stages of changes, they think action is the only thing. And so they move from pre-contemplation to action without doing these other steps. Outcomes aren't quite as good when you skip steps in this. And you can see here, whoops, I didn't mean to hit that one. You can see here that it runs in a cycle, and so what could happen is relapse. Here's another term you might want to change. We're not calling it relapse anymore. We're calling it a setback. Because relapse sounds like something that the person did or didn't do that they shouldn't have. They did something they shouldn't have done or didn't do something they should have done. And so we're just calling it a setback. Because a setback doesn't mean, boy, you messed up, it's all over now, you're over with, you might as well just give up and forget about making whatever change it was you wanted to make. Well, setback says, hey, that's something to be expected. You know, it's two steps, change is a process. It's two steps forward, one step back. And so setback would be a better term to use there. That's another change that's come in edition 3. So if you've implemented your plan, some processes require maintenance, which means you do something on a regular basis to make sure. People go on diets, on and off diets all the time. And I tell people, I mean, this is just my own opinion. You can differ with it if you like. It's okay not to go on a diet, but change the plan they have and stay with the plan that you've changed to. You have to maintain it every day. Because if you don't, and you revert back to old behaviors, you're going to get the same thing you got when you had the old behaviors. And then some of them are termination. We learn how to swim. We learn how to drive a car. We learn how to ride a bike. We don't have to think about that anymore. You can just go do it. So those you don't, you know, so you're done with that. Here's another depiction of it that shows the nature of change as a cyclical kind of process where you make progress for a while, you begin to level off, and sometimes even regress a little bit, and then you get ahead of steam and start working through the process again. That just shows that. And I show this to patients, and they kind of appreciate it, because a lot of times I think they come with the expectation that here's my problem, this guy's going to tell me what to do to fix it, and I'll do it and live happily ever after. You know, they look at change as an event and not a process, and then once they get into the process of changing and they find out, wow, this isn't as easy as I had hoped it would be, they begin to realize. So this is helpful to them. It makes them feel more comfortable about their struggles in change. Here's another way to look at the stages of change and how a mismatch between the therapist, the clinician, if you will, and the patient can create difficulties in changing. For example, if somebody comes into you and they're thinking about maybe getting more exercise, but they haven't totally committed yet, and you're going, well, between now and the next time we meet, I want you to run a 5-mile marathon. I'm exaggerating to make the point here, but obviously that's going to create some problems in the relationship, isn't it? Because they're not ready for that. So gauging the stage of readiness throughout the process of working with people is really important. Here's another way to look at how motivation can change even about a certain single issue over time. Sometimes people are motivated about an issue and you see them the next time and all of a sudden that's not even on their radar. They're not even talking about it. So it shifts back and forth. And think about our own process and the changes we made in our own lives. So sometimes people are not ready, and that would be a 1, and very ready over here at a 10. And as you can see, you can shift along that continuum. One of the most powerful aspects of motivational interviewing, and I can remember vividly when I first became aware of this. I was in the training in Albuquerque, and I was in like day 4. And it was the one that we did with Bill Miller. And I suddenly became so aware that if I said this to the person, we were doing what we call real plays, where we take real life situations and play them out in a training, that it's likely to get that response from a patient, the pretend patient, the actor. And if I said this, they would probably go in that direction. And it was like, it scared me a little bit. I thought, wow. So this is very powerful. So what we say influences where they end up. Not that we're totally responsible. It's the client's responsibility to change. But we can either create discord or create an environment where change is much more likely. Here are the 6 steps again. I'll just run through these real quick because most of you are familiar with that. Here's an ancillary stage. I put relapse and recycling. Here again, we could say setback if you like. And then recycling means if you have a problem and you've fallen off the wagon, for example, rather than giving up and just decided that it's not worthwhile, you become so disillusioned that you feel like you've failed and there's no hope. We don't do that. We build in the recycling part as a part of the process. And that's what I explain this to patients. If you have troubles or you backslide or have a setback, don't take that as total failure. We've got a place you can start back to contemplation or preparation, and usually people go to preparation because something happened in their process of change they didn't anticipate in their initial preparation stage. So you go back there and say, how do we allow for this? I had a guy who's been sober for over 90 days, and over New Year's, his wife and child took a trip, and he was home by himself, and he drank an 8-pack of beer while she was gone. Well, I saw him last week, and after that slip, as they call it in AA. He got back on the wagon and started going to meetings and hadn't used since. So he had a setback, and he didn't give up, and he didn't become totally disillusioned and not put forth any more effort. So that was an example of that. Here they are again. If you're looking just as a general way of thinking about it, if they're going in that direction, they're making progress. If they're moving in that direction, they're having a setback. By the way, I went through these slides probably 6 months ago to update everything. And I don't know how many of you have had this experience. When you're proofreading your own stuff, you keep seeing, and I missed a lot of these things that I'm going to change when I get back home. But so that word will come out of there and be replaced by a setback. Okay, here's another way of looking at it. If you look at the book Changing for Good, which was written by Prochaska, Norcross, and Diclemte, and I think this came out in the early 90s, they have processes for each one of these. So to clarify, stages of change and motivational interviewing are two separate processes. They're both effective. They dovetail fairly well because motivational interviewing is a way to help people move through these stages. But in this book, they detail what I think is a little bit more complex and complicated ways of getting people to move through the stages. But it's another way. Have any of you ever heard of the readiness ruler? A readiness ruler could be used, and actually, I don't know if there's an example of that in the handout or not. I wasn't sure we'd get to that, so I don't see it there. But one of the ways you can use that, is there one in there? Okay. Is ask people, you know, where do you think you are? You were talking about, you know, maybe I should stop smoking pot because my doctor tells me I have chronic bronchitis. My wife tells me I seem to be foggy every morning when I wake up. You know, people have told me that I'm more anxious than I used to be. That sounds like an experienced pot smoker saying that kind of stuff. I gave you a little hint. I'm working on my 30th year in recovery, so I did smoke a bunch of pot when I was in the active stage of my disease, so I'm glad I'm not doing that anymore. And I actually did have some of these things. So at some point, you can say, where are you on this 0 to 10 scale or 1 to 10 scale in terms of readiness to do anything about your problem? And that gives you some idea of where they are in the stages. So you want to gear your interventions to each of these stages. Don't give someone who's in contemplation an action-oriented assignment. You know, it'll be ships passing in the night. You're not going to connect. So as a matter of fact, it'll break the connection you have with your patient. And a lot of times, they'll try to do what we want them to do to please us, and they're not ready. So they go out and they have another frustration, and the result of their treatment is, I'm more frustrated than I was when I came. We don't want that. That's not the outcome any of us want. So here's a way to avoid that, by checking the level of readiness throughout the process of change. These are the tasks of the therapist during each of these stages. I'm going to get through that so we can get more into motivational interviewing. So you can look that up if you want. Here are the patient tasks that go along with each of the stages. If anybody wants more information, we can get that later. Here's a summary. Whoops. It's about the process of change, and the key word there is process. It's compatible with different models. I tend to be a cognitive behavior, REBT-oriented, interpersonal therapy-oriented therapist. I also use pieces of reality therapy and neuro-linguistic programming and whatever I think would help that person. I've been fortunate enough to be trained in a lot of different schools, but mostly probably cognitively based. Seems to have the best outcomes. But the stage of change of motivational interviewing are both very compatible with using other ways. Change occurs all the time. People are changing all the time. The question is, what changes are they making? And we can help guide those changes. one way or another, by the way we interact with people. Many people change without help. Tom McClellan, who's the, I think he's CEO is his title, of the Treatment Research Institute, says that there are more people who have recovered on their own from addiction than there are people who have had any kind of treatment or support recovery process. I don't know how he gets that information, but that's what he says, and it's probably true. A lot of people just figure out, hey, I've got a problem, I need to do something about it. But we don't hear about those. So probably in our professional lives, we're getting the more serious cases, people that may have already made efforts to quit or stop or cut down and haven't been successful. Pardon?
Dry drunks.
Dry drunks, yeah. People fluctuate along the stages of change, which is what we talked about earlier, emphasizes positive reasons for change. So when you're using stages of change, you want to emphasize that. Now, with motivational interviewing, you sort of take a neutral posture. You're not encouraging one way or another. You're trying to elicit or tap into their own intrinsic desires for which way they want to go. People require more motivation in the early stages. That's obvious. In the old model of motivational interviewing, we had a phase one and a phase two, and we're going to talk about that. Typically, what most of us need help with is phase one skills. Phase two is more about, okay, they've decided to make the change. Now, what methods can they use to get there? We're all very good at that. So, you know, we're going to talk about mostly phase one. And they don't use phase one or phase two in addition three, which will become obvious, the reasons for which will become obvious when we get into that. Combined with MI, it helps people decide on their own a plan of action. Have you ever heard of the writing reflex, R-I-G-H-T-I-N-G? We're going to talk about that a little bit later, but basically it's our tendency to want to fix something. Sometimes people will say things to me in the course of a conversation in counseling or therapy, and my brain just starts clicking off a list of, have you tried this? Have you tried that? Have you thought about this? Well, what about that? Well, go do this. And, you know, I've been taught in MI to restrain from sharing that stuff, because to the person, the unintended message, the possible unintended message is to say, well, you're so stupid and you're so incompetent, you probably haven't thought of these things on your own. Here, let me be your hero and I'll fix you. Let me be the knight in shining armor rescuing the damsel or dame in distress, okay? And that's not what we want to communicate. Now, it comes from a helping place. I mean, our heart's in the right place. We want to be helpful to people. But sometimes it can create more of a disconnect or discord in the relationship that we have with our clients. So we're calling this avoid the writing reflex or the need to fix. Al-Anon's based on that same principle, isn't it? That you don't do it for the other person. You help them do it for themselves. It's a different, little different twist. This is something by Charles Darwin, who people think it's mostly the strongest of the species that survives, not the most intelligent, but the one most responsive to change. Survival of the fittest is really survival of the one who is willing to change. Let me get myself caught up here in my notebook, because there's some things I want to make sure I say to you. Okay. Here are some principles of person-centered change. When I say person-centered, is there any famous psychologist that comes to mind? Carl Rogers. A lot of MI sounds like it's Rogerian. It is to a degree, but motivational interviewing is a little more guiding than Rogers just reflecting all the time. Our service exists to benefit others. One of the reasons I went into this little exercise was just to demonstrate an MI technique that we're here to say, what do you want? I mean, sometimes I'll look at an intake sheet and it'll say on there, a person has called to make an appointment because they have a drinking problem. You know, but I don't start there with that. You know, sometimes, especially if the wife called and made the initial appointment, that guy might not even know there's a drinking problem. So you start with what the person wants, and it might not always match what we as clinicians think they need in the beginning. You know, the difference between a presenting problem and the diagnosis can be different sometimes. So change is fundamentally self-change. One of the reasons I like motivational interviewing is it emphasizes that basic counseling 101 principle is that the client is responsible for change, we're not. Because you can feel a lot of pressure to try to say, gosh, I'm in private practice, so I'm going, gee, I want this person to get their money's worth. I got to really, you know, do something extravagant or dramatic and, you know, have them going out of here and living happily ever after two sessions of chronic disease, okay? So it doesn't happen to work that way. People are experts on themselves, and what we want to do is become experts on their expertise about themselves. We don't make change happen. We don't have to come up with all the solutions. Now, there's a part in motivational interviewing which says how you give advice, and it's typically with permission or if the patient or client asks you directly. I mean, I can assume if somebody's coming to my office, they want advice. But in the course of the conversation, I don't just jump into that. I'll say, is it okay if I give you some feedback? Or is it okay if I tell you what some other people have found helpful? It still opens that up because you're minimizing discord or what we used to call resistance. You know, sometimes if you talk with people in such a way that they feel attacked, they're going to defend themselves psychologically. And so if they feel some need to defend, there's a disconnect in the communication, there's a disconnect in the rapport, there's a disconnect in the relationship. So it's one of the things I like about motivational interviewing is it's very respectful, it's very courteous, and in a way it takes the pressure off the clinician for the change. Our job is to guide the change by constructive, reflective listening, which we're going to talk about in more detail. People have their own resources. In other words, we don't have to plug things in. Now, that's not always true. Sometimes people lack knowledge about certain resources in the community, and you can tell them about it, and they go, well, I didn't know about that. That sounds appropriate. I think I'll give that a shot. But in terms of their ability to make change, one of the sayings I use is that the oak is in the acorn. That everything that little acorn needs to produce this great massive tree is in there. It needs nurturing, water, soil, sunlight. That's our job. But the resource for that is already existing within that seed. Does that make sense? Okay. Change requires a collaborative experience. It's doing something in partnership, doing something together. If that person could make that change on their own, they wouldn't be in our office. There wouldn't be any need for them to come and see us. So we become change experts. I've been doing therapy for close to 40 years now, and I remember the first several years of practice, I never used the word change talk. Although that's what we were doing, I didn't hear it in conferences, I didn't hear it in workshops, I didn't hear it anywhere until I got to motivational interviewing. And they teach you specifically to watch for different types of change talk and how to respond to that change talk. You start where the client is. How many social workers are in here? I got that drilled into me. I have an MSW, and so when you get social work training, you always start where the client is. And as Stephen Covey's book, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, one of the things that he talked about was the 7 habits was seek first to understand. Anyone familiar with the prayer of St. Francis? It's a wonderful prayer. I practiced it every morning for 2 years to try to inculcate those ideas within my approach in my life and in working with people professionally. But it's we do better to seek an understanding of where our clients are coming from as opposed to trying to get them to understand things we might want to impose on them. And if I hear a client say, well, you don't understand, I say, well, let's keep working till I do. That might be true, but let's keep working till I do. And I said, thank you for helping me be aware of that. As opposed to, no, you don't understand. I'm the expert here, and by gosh, you're supposed to listen to me. Let me just shove this stuff down your throat, and you'll be fine. Okay, we don't do that. Conversation about change is not a power trip. Now, I've known some providers, clinicians that I know and respect, who use that authority position very well in eliciting change from people. I'm not one of these people. It's not my nature. So MI comes kind of naturally for me. I mean, I can confront people's issues. I can do that if I have to. I start, hopefully, with the most assertive way of dealing with things. But if I have to get aggressive, I can do that. But I rarely have to using motivational interviewing because it's a way that keeps resistance so low that it rarely ever comes up as something you'd need to do. Motivation is evoked, not installed. It's something we're trying to help, encourage, or elicit out of someone, not something we're trying to put in. And motivation, it's not a change goal until the client adopts it. You know, you hear somebody talking about, oh, I've been drinking 18 beers a night for the past 5 years, and you immediately think, well, you got to stop drinking. You got to stop drinking. Well, guess what? No, they don't. No, they don't. And guess what? They're not going to unless they say, I better stop drinking. You get that? Am I in change? What is motivational interviewing? What's it for? Why would I want to learn this? How do I use it? Those are things we're going to start to talk about. Things do not change. We do. MI is about arranging conversations so that people talk themselves into change. So you can ask questions in a certain way, make a reflection in a certain way that gets somebody to elaborate more. And when they start elaborating, then you have the option to respond to that in certain ways. And we're going to talk about some of the ways you can respond. Whoops. Motivation is a fire from within. If someone else tries to light that fire under you, chances are it'll burn out very, it will burn very briefly. A friend of mine says that most people don't change. What is it? Most people don't change when they feel the heat. They change when they see the light. Except for adolescence, and it's just backwards. Sorry, I was just kidding. All right. People change voluntarily only when they become interested in the change, and they perceive a need to change. So sometimes our questions will get about, why might it be important for you to make some changes? That gets to the question of need. They become convinced that change is in their best interest, not in our best interest. Well, you better change or your wife's going to leave you. Well, he might go, well, I'm sure going to miss her. Remember that Brad Paisley song about taking the dog fishing? Anyway, they organize a plan of action and are committed. Now, somebody might give lip service to change. I say to people all the time, lip service is cheap except in my office. But they don't ever devise a plan, and they don't ever really commit to it. And so if you start noticing that, there are certain questions and statements you can make that might help them become more aware of that and move into the planning stage. They take steps necessary. When we get to darn cat, that'll be part of that process, taking the steps. Sources of motivation. There's external pressure and internal motivation. Externally motivated subjects had long-term outcomes only when they also had high levels of internal motivation. A lot of people come to us externally motivated. They might be mandated by the court, an employer, a spouse might say, you better do something or I'm out of here. Some people will say, you know, my teachers at school are on my back or whatever. And hopefully through that process, they convert that external pressure into internal motivation. How many of us have had clients that started going to their first AA meetings with a bracelet on their ankle because the judge said, you got to go? And would say in the beginning, I don't really need to be here. This is all, you know, I shouldn't be here. This is unfair. That cop was picking on me. I hadn't had that much to drink. I wasn't really drunk. And now again, this judge is making me do all this stuff. And then 6 months later, they're there going, you know, I'm working on my third step now, and I'm really glad I'm here, and boy, my life is starting to get a lot better. So it's a shift between that external pressure and the internal motivation. Internal motivation is enhanced by autonomy. Whoops. What is autonomy? Pardon?
Power to change.
The power to change. It's freedom of choice and therefore the power to change. So we're not taking away anybody's options. We're adding to them. We're putting tools in the bag, not taking tools out. Competence. That person has to have some sense of self-efficacy that they have the ability to make the changes that they've been offered. Freedom of choice is expressed in motivational interviewing by offering a menu of options. There's another little catchphrase. We offer people a menu of options, not here's the only way you can get there. Relatedness, the relationship heals. Anybody that's been engaged in counseling or psychotherapy for any amount of time will know, and research verifies this time and time again since the early 50s, that it's not us doing it, it's not the client doing it, but it's the nature of our relationship together that heals. And part of our job is to provide people a safe, secure place to make the changes they need to make and to talk about the sensitive issues that they may have that brought them to your doorstep. New findings, motivation predicts action. That's like a duh, okay? But motivation is changeable. People, like I said earlier, might be motivated at one point to do all kinds of things, and then their motivation wanes. And that's okay, it's a part of the process. You accept it as a natural, normal part of helping people get from one point to another. It's behavior specific. They might be really motivated to get more sleep, but not so motivated to stop drinking. It's interactive. The change occurs as the result of the interaction in the relationship. And I know you're hearing me say this in different ways over and over and over again, but that's very, very important. Internal motivation lasts longer than external. Key concepts. Motivation is the application of energy to act in pursuit of some goal. Most people trust themselves more than others. People learn about their own attitudes by hearing themselves talk. Boy, that's very important. You know, how many times have you heard say, I just said that and I can't believe that. Wow. You know, that's an aha moment for that person. Change is an inside job that flows from internal motivation. Used to be a bumper sticker that said happiness is an inside job many years ago. I'd see that. So it's similar to that. MI is not done to or on someone. It's done for and with. You know, a little different than surgery, wouldn't you say? A motivational conversation entails capturing change talk and using it in a manner that moves one in the direction of their goals. I quoted myself there, just so I could see my own name in print. So that's all right. You are a midwife assisting someone else's birth. Facilitate what is happening rather than what you think ought to change. Look where that came from, 2,500 years ago. So this is not new stuff. We're just using it more consciously. This is interesting. Probability of behavior change. If the clinician talks about why change is important, the client nods their head. Low likelihood of change. Client thinks about why change is personally important. They're moving in the direction toward their goals. That's good. Client talks about why change is personally important. Client makes verbal commitment to change. I am calling the YMCA today. That's an example. And so the likelihood of them changing is much higher when you hear that. And this is a definition out of the textbook. We'll not do that. Layperson's definition. Motivational interviewing is a collaborative conversational style for strengthening a person's own motivation and commitment to change. And this is out of MI3, the third edition. Motivational interviewing is a person-centered counseling style for addressing common problems of ambivalence about change. And ambivalence is an issue that's big in any change process. Motivational interviewing is the only place where I've seen ambivalence become the conscious object of attention. And we're going to talk more about why that's true. Ambivalence and change is a very important part. And I remember in my early training, I never heard anybody talking about ambivalence. We might have mentioned it in passing, but it wasn't that big a deal. In motivational interviewing, one of the goals is to help people work through their ambivalence about change, because we all feel two ways about things sometimes at the same time. You know, I want to get to bed earlier so I can get more sleep, but daggone it, all these good sports news broadcasts come late at night and I want to see what the scores are, you know. And so we go, part of us wants to make the change and another part of us wants to stay the same. And it's sometimes conscious, a lot of times it's unconscious. I mean, it's happening below the radar. We don't even know we're into that. This is what motivational interviewing is not. It's not just being nice. It's okay if you're nice, but that's not motivational interviewing. It's not Rogerian therapy, as I said earlier. It's a little more guiding, directing. It's not a technique. It's really more of a way of being with someone. When we get to talk about the spirit of motivational interviewing, and I hope we have time, I have a little 7-minute video piece where Bill Miller and Stephen Rollnick are talking about the spirit of motivational interviewing. So if you don't get anything else from this training today, at least walk out of here with a sense of spirit. And when you do, not only will your work become less stressful, but your life will be affected in positive ways. Because I learned how to ask open-ended questions to people in my life, my family. You know, a lot of times because I'm in this profession, you know, you get the hook sometimes. Come over here, tell me what to do about this. Not going there. Don't take the bait. That's what I call it. It's not a panacea. It doesn't work for everything. And as a matter of fact, there are some places, like any other approach, that could be contraindicated. So there are places where you can use it and make things worse. It's not a comprehensive theory of change, because that's not what it's supposed to be. It's a way of having a change conversation with somebody. It's not transactional or trans-theoretical model. That's the stages of change, which we just went through. Here again, they're separate systems. Each have their own change process, but they work pretty well together. And I learned to do this in the beginning of using motivational interviewing to help people get through the stages of change, and I haven't been convinced since then, over the 20 years I've been doing this, to not use those two together. It just seems to make sense, and it's easy. And if you explain both systems to people that you're working with, sometimes that, you know, they're more engaged and they understand what's going on and therefore more likely to cooperate and participate. There's a technique used in motivational interviewing sometimes to help resolve ambivalence called the decisional balance. And some people think that the decisional balance, where they have the four cells about, you know, what's the good things about making the change you want to make, what's the not so good, what's the good things about status quo, what's the not so good, that's a quick summary of the decisional balance, and it's just one part of something you can incorporate in MI to help resolve people's ambivalence, but it's not all of MI. It's not assessment and feedback. Feedback's not required. There's a type of approach using motivational interviewing principles called motivational enhancement therapy, which has like 7 specific things you're supposed to do in the course, and one of them is you give people rapid assessment instruments and then you give them feedback about that. MI doesn't do that. There's nothing wrong with doing it, but it's not MI. It's motivational enhancement therapy, which is a little bit different. And it's not a way of manipulating people, although in each edition, edition 1, edition 2, and edition 3 of what I call the Bible or the text of motivational interviewing, there's a section about the ethical use of motivational interviewing principles, because as I said earlier, once you start getting good at this, you can start to say, you know what, if I wasn't doing this in a way that was couched in some kind of ethical, scrupulous process to really help somebody better their lives, I could see how this could be used to influence people against their best interests. And that's not what this is about. So there's a section in each one about the ethical use of motivational interviewing. I've seen people talk about, what was the one I saw? Somebody had something on the internet, and I don't know whatever happened to it or whether it ever got off the ground, but somebody was going to train car salesmen in motivational interviewing. I don't think that's such a good idea. You see what I'm saying? Okay, how to learn. Openness to the underlying assumptions and spirit MI helps increase your proficiency. Proficiency in client-centered interpersonal skills, accurate empathy. What is empathy? Somebody tell me what your understanding or definition of empathy is. Understanding somebody else's inner experience? Excellent. Accurate empathy in motivational interviewing is that plus the ability to communicate to the client that you understand their inner experience. So it's understanding and communicating that to the person so that they know we're on the same page. We're in the same boat, we're rowing in the same direction. Because if people don't think you understand, your credibility goes down, doesn't it? Actually, this guy I was telling you about that drank over the holidays, his first question to me, he sat down in the seat, didn't even start the interview, I just met him. This is the only time in 40 years this has ever happened. The guy says, "Are you in recovery?" This never happened before. I thought, wow, this is kind of weird. And I said, yeah. And he said, good. It's like, just that was enough for him to say, oh, he's going to understand where I'm coming from. So, you know, I got to, just to, by virtue of my own life experience, got off to a good start with this guy. Okay. So accurate empathy is being able to communicate the person's meaning. Recognize change talk and commitment language. Minimize resistance. That should be discord, by the way, in responding to sustained talk. What's sustained talk? Have you heard that term before? It's kind of weird. I just made it up to see if you guys were still awake. No, I didn't.
It's like their steady state.
Yeah, status quo. It's a status quo. It's no change, okay? Sustained talk. And people will have talk that it's like, how many of you have said sometime along the way to somebody, this is after you have a good relationship with them so you can take this risk, and say, I don't know if you're aware of it, but you're defending something that's hurting you. When they defend the status quo, a lot of their talk will be about, here's how I'm going to hang on to my problem. You know, you're being offered a way to let go of it, yet your talk indicates that you're going to keep the status quo. So it's we recognize that as a natural part of the change process, and you learn ways to respond to it. Okay. Skill in eliciting and responding to change talk, that's an important skill, and that's an important skill. Formulate an effective change plan. It's up to the person to do this, but you can help guide them through that. Most of us probably are pretty good already at doing that. Elicit commitment to the plan. Sometimes once somebody has a plan, and this is written, by the way, and there's an example of a change plan sheet in your handouts, hopefully the person at the end walks out the door with that plan completed. And we all have a sigh of relief. And we say, don't forget the wallet biopsy on the way out. You know what that is? That's where they stop and pay for services. And then we forget about it. But I say, you know, give yourself a couple weeks at implementing this, and then I want to see you back, maybe 2 weeks, a month later, just to see where they are. Because sometimes just the fact that they have the plan, we think, okay, they've got it. They know what to do. They're going to do it. Well, they might have done some of it. They might have not done any of it. They might be trying too hard to the point where they're about to burn out, so they need a little guidance. So you continue with the process. Blending MI with other therapies is another way to learn the skills. Explore and resolve ambivalence. Just as we're constantly gauging a person's steady or level of readiness along the way, we're also looking at the ambivalence. And it'll come out in the way they talk to you. You'll hear that ambivalence. Part of them is reluctant to make the change. They understand the need, and they know that it would be very helpful to them, but there's something else going on. So if you can get them to voice that, sometimes just hearing themselves make that defense to stay where they are is an important awareness. Where people get stuck. This is actually the opposite of what we just did, except for this one, collecting bouquets. That's summarizing. Anyone familiar with ORS as far as motivational interviewing is concerned? O-A-R-S. Okay, that's one of the core skills. We will talk about that some. And there's a sheet and a handout on that that shows you how to use that. This is a kind of an interesting little statement. I'll just let you read it. Kind of a common sense sort of thing. What's the other one about? how do you get to something? And they say, practice, practice, practice. What is it? Anyone remember that one?
Carnegie Hall.
Yeah, how do you get to Carnegie Hall? Yeah. Okay. Here are four vital aspects of practicing the spirit of motivational interviewing. It's a collaborative partnership. Some people use the phrase, would we rather dance or wrestle? Think about the difference between those two things. Dancing is when you have cooperation and people are moving in flow with one another. Where people are wrestling, it's an adversarial power struggle, one trying to dominate the other, which is totally different. And I'll tell you, if you start feeling frustration and stress in working with somebody, that's a good time to ask yourself if you're not wrestling. And if you discover that you're wrestling, there's nothing to be ashamed of in that. It's just a signal to relax and change. And some of the things you can do with motivational interviewing, if all else fails, ask a question or provide a reflection. You know, and I've actually said to somebody, you know, wait a minute, I'm confused here. We need a reset. I got to reboot here. I'm kind of like got away from what we're here to do. Let's talk about what are your original goals were. You know, so sometimes you do things to reorient yourself or re-engage. Acceptance. This is the big thing Carl Rogers talked about, is they accept that person as a sort of unconditional acceptance of others. And I would include unconditional self-acceptance in that too. You know, none of us are perfect, and we're going to make mistakes. The difference is today, and partly because of my recovery, and partly because of what I've learned in motivational interviewing, it's a lot easier for me to say, you know what, I dropped a ball on that one. I got totally detoured here. Let me just take a break. And, you know, people appreciate that. It's almost like we've given them permission to have the faux pas they have too. And so it, you know, it relaxes things. So it's a matter of just being honest with yourself and not getting into a bunch of shame about the fact that you're not perfect. I heard some politician not too long ago say, don't make perfect the enemy of the good enough. I like that. And so evocation, here again, we're drawing things from within. The person always already has the resources. Now, they might not have the skill set. They might not have all the information or knowledge they need, but that's something that we can easily add or direct them toward, but in terms of changing the resources in them. And then it's compassionate. I think the Dalai Lama wrote an entire book about compassion. So you combine all those, and you have the spirit of MI. And I'll tell you what, it's a much more pleasant place to operate from as a clinician. And it seems like, I mean, I even had people tell me this. It was like, well, there's nothing happening here. Well, you're not doing anything, you know. And then you look at, here's where the person came in. I actually do use a few measurement tools, by the way, and always have. I had a great research teacher, evaluative research teacher in my master's training, my MSW. And I've used little rapid assessment instruments since I started practice, and now we're hearing third-party payers saying you better be doing that. But I always have liked them, and I call them, this is the closest we can get to a psycho-emotional x-ray. You know, here's where you are now. We measure throughout the progress of treatment. Some people get worse before they get better. Some people don't get better. Sometimes I say, you know, I'm doing everything I know to do. This is apparently not working. You'd be willing to go get a second opinion or talk to somebody else. Most of the time, people won't do it, though. Ah, we'll work through this. You know, if you've got a good relationship with them, they'll hang in there with you. Sometimes I'll say, could you hold on to that issue till next week? I'm kind of dealing with that one myself. Not very often, but it does happen. The spirit. It's a spirit of collaboration, not confrontation, evocation versus education. It's autonomy, not authority. It's a mind and heart set. Here are the four aspects of acceptance. You recognize and honor everybody's absolute worth, their freedom of choice. You reflect accurately. Reflective listening will reflect what the person is saying, plus the feelings that are behind that. And we'll talk more about some of the responses in motivational interviewing that help you do that. And you're affirming all along the way. Hey, you suited up and showed up today. That's something. You know? I get people sometimes that they're so demoralized, they don't think that anything they do has any value. They feel worthless. Nothing they do is constructive. I said, you got yourself up out of bed, put clothes on, came to the office. You're already in the process of making a change. So let's build on that. Does that make sense? Yes. Oh, time for a break. Okay, let's do 5 minutes, and then when we come back, we'll do the video. What we're going to see here for the next 7 minutes are the creators of motivational interviewing, Dr. Stephen Rollnick, who's on the far, I guess that would be your left, Dr. Bill Miller's in the middle, and this is Terry Moyers, who works with them out at the University of New Mexico. Mm-hmm. But I wanted to share a couple of really witty words of wisdom from Stephen Wright. Y'all remember him? He said someone sent him a picture postcard of Earth, and on the back of it they said they had written, "Wish you were here." If a person with multiple personalities threatens suicide, is that considered a hostage situation? If a cow laughed, would milk come out its nose? Why do they sterilize needles for a lethal injection? These are all weighty questions we all need to concern ourselves with. So, we've talked a lot about the spirit of motivational interviewing, and I don't know how better to capture that than to give you these guys. And it's we can't turn these center lights out for some reason or dim them, so I think you can still follow this, though. Booth lights. That doesn't do anything. So whoever was in the booth just got... Okay, I will start this, and we'll entertain questions afterwards.
And the influence of Carl Rogers.
I was quite influenced by Rogers. In my own training, happily, I was trained both in cognitive behavioral approaches and in this client-centered approach of Rogers. And in some of my early research, I was looking at how those two things come together, how you can do a behavioral kind of therapy and yet have that client-centered spirit. And in one study that we did, where we were observing 9 different therapists, we were using a scale developed by Roger Stoops to see the extent to which they were showing accurate empathy. That is, how well are they listening to the people that they're sitting with? How well do they understand what the person says, and how well do they reflect it back to them? And we kept track of that. And the surprise in that study was that that, more than anything else, was accounting for how much change we saw in problem drinking. It actually accounted for 2/3 of the variance in outcome, how well this behavior therapist was listening to the client they're sitting with. And that got my attention. And then we got that finding just before I went off to Norway.
Right.
And so I went off thinking, you know, that here's something about the relationship between client and counselor that looks like it's really important and that hasn't gotten very much emphasis, certainly in the cognitive behavioral community at that time. I think that carries over very much into motivational interviewing, this empathic listening way of being, and that skill of reflective listening has been an important part of motivational interviewing.
Yeah, and at the heart of the humanistic extreme, so to speak.
Yes, yes.
And that humanistic sort of client-centered stream really flows into the spirit of motivational interviewing, which has 4 components. And one of those components is the collaborative relationship between two people in which power is relatively equally shared. What else?
Yeah, and that's right. It's a partnership between people, and they both bring expertise. One of them, perhaps professional expertise, but the client, as I said, no one has more expertise about him or her than that client does. So that's one important piece of it. inside, seeing the world through that person's eyes, and being in a non-judgmental, accepting kind of way with people. So that's the second piece.
And then the third, another, is evocation, where it's quite an active process in which you are drawing out that wisdom from the client. And in motivational interview, a new perspective and resolution of ambivalence that helps promote change.
Mm-hmm. In an expert kind of model, it's almost like the counselor is applying, I have the answer to your problems.
Yeah.
And I'm going to dispense it to you. I'm going to install it into you. And motivational interviewing doesn't say, I have what you need. It says, you have what you need.
Yeah.
And together we're going to find it.
Yeah, and I think quite a striking experience I've had in practice and in training people has been the need for people to sit on their hands, so to speak, when they're evoking and not impose their material or their clever ideas or their clever questions on people, and have their mind relatively uncluttered.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of motivation has to do with restraint.
Yes, what you don't do. And you've talked about a new component, a fourth element to the spirit of motivational interviewing, and that is compassion. What led you to think about adding compassion?
Yeah, what led us to add that was that if you don't have that, really the other three can all be done as a way of manipulating a person, or even a person trying to sell something to someone will naturally take a sort of partnership collaborative style, will be interested in hearing what would you like, what's interesting to you in this, and be evoking that from the other person, have a sort of accepting, friendly atmosphere. And it's being done with the purpose of selling something to the person.
Mm-hmm.
And that's definitely not what's going on in motivational interviewing. So when we were thinking what's missing, and what was missing is to say the reason that we're having this conversation is to promote the other person's best interest, is to help them find where they are going.
Yes,
it's not done for us.
That's right, and like looking back over more than 20 years, I think there were definitely people interested in effectively what Bill was describing was selling cars, mm-hmm. using MI to sell cars. So that's one of the origins of using the word compassion. Another one was, I think, our own struggles with trying to come to terms with the ethics of these difficult conversations about change. And it just struck us that the word compassion helps to resolve some of these ethical challenges. It's just a simple word. It means quite a lot. But it keeps the interviewer on a safe path with somebody if they feel that they experience and express compassion for the other, then motivation of interviewing is there for them.
I'm here for this person. It's client-centered to that.
Yeah.
In that sense. So those four pieces flow together to form this underlying spirit of motivational interviewing. And we started writing about that, actually, because we saw people using the method in a way doing exactly what we had taught them, and we were dismayed. That obviously we had missed something in trying to teach this, and it was just too much focus on technique,
mm-hmm.
and not enough on what's the heart set and the mindset behind it. Why are you doing this? Where is this going? What's this relationship?
Yeah, and that's what we call the spirit of motivation interview, and it's an expression of that humanistic strength.
Yeah.
Any questions, concerns, comments about that? I always think it's helpful if you can see the folks that designed this model so that you get some idea. And Bill Miller and Stephen Rollnick are both involved in extensive research. And one of the things that I appreciate about being a member of the Motivational Interviewing Network of Trainers is these guys are constantly doing research and refining this. They're finding ways to make it better, more efficient, more effective. So I have a lot of respect for how they handle that. Continuum of communication styles. One is directing, and motivational interviewing is more about guiding. There is some directional nature to it that you'll see, but it's heavily focused more on guiding than following or directing, which you'll see. Here's some verbs that are associated with each style, and you can see that it's accompanying, arousing, assisting, awaken, collaborate, elicit, encourage, enlighten, inspire, as opposed to ordering, managing, conducting, commanding, and then following is, this probably might be a little more Rogerian on this side. So that can help you appreciate some of the nature of what motivational interviewing does. These are the four main processes of motivational interviewing that you do throughout. It looks like they're each discrete steps, but you're sort of melding this into the process. And that's where practice comes in. You got to do this for a while before you become comfortable with it. And I'm going to give you some suggestions about what I did in my early efforts toward trying to get better at this. And this was the things that I did were before these steps were a part of. So this comes from Motivational Interviewing, the third edition. Engaging is the relational foundation. You know, part of me walking around and saying hi to you guys and asking you what you wanted was a part of an engaging process, so I'm trying to model what I'm teaching here. Focusing is the strategic direction. If you don't focus on where they want to go, you're going to end up someplace else. Evoking is preparing for change, evoking change talk so that you know how to respond to it. Evoking goal setting for them, you know, what do you want to get from this? And then planning is the bridge to change. And if you look at this in regards to stages of change, this is preparatory change talk and then mobilizing change talk. So you're doing things early in the process to help elicit change talk, and then you're responding to that in such a way toward the, and you can do this within sessions, you can see it as a process over time, over multiple sessions, and so it's learning this whole approach of where you're coming from that you'll begin to find yourself using unconsciously after you've practiced it for a while. Here's another way of thinking about it. MI methods, engaging, focusing, evoking, planning, so you're moving in that direction. Questions regarding each process. Engaging, you start to wonder, how comfortable is this person in talking to me? You're kind of looking at what's their comfort level. Are they giving you signs that they're displeased? Or not that you're not going to run upon issues in therapy where people are going to be a little bit uncomfortable. I mean, that's a natural part of it. And I even talk to people about that. I said, you know, some days you'll probably leave here, you know, people start crying, they're upset, but it means we're getting to stuff they need to get to. But overall, the process should be that they leave most sessions feeling more hopeful, more empowered, with some specific ideas of what steps to take to help them get to where they want to go. How supportive and helpful am I being? Again, part of the engaging process. What are you doing to engage this person? Do I understand their perspective and concerns? And I find myself saying from time to time, let me make sure I got this. And then I'll reflect to that person what they've said, usually in the form of a summary. They've told you a little bit about what they're going through. How comfortable do I feel in this conversation? If we're feeling like we're pushing something on somebody, or it's forced, or it's not authentic, or it's not sincere, then we need to back off and take a look at what we're doing and maybe look at doing something different. How does this feel like a collaborative? Does this feel like a collaborative relationship? One time, several years ago, I had this 18-year-old boy who was having some problems. His mother came in for, I don't know, session six or something. And we did a review with him, with his permission, of all the issues that he had. And we listed like eight different things that were going on with this kid, any one of which could have been focus of professional help. And at the end of it, he said, "You see, Mom, I don't have any problems. I don't need to be here." And in my mind, I thought, well, that's the biggest bunch of bullshit I've ever heard. And this other little voice said, "Bill, whatever you do, do not let that come out of your mouth." as I'm watching these words trail out of my mouth. You know, elementary mistake. And the guy gets up and says, F you, Bill, and he runs out of the office. And the mother looks at me and says, do you see what I got to put up with? And I'm sitting there going, I cannot believe I just did that. You know, it was predictable as 2 + 2 = 4 that I was going to get some kind of reaction like that. I don't know why I said that. It was a weak moment. I can make all kinds of excuses, but it was totally inappropriate. I wanted to say, okay, Mom's on my side. I was going to say, well, I just did that on purpose because of the therapeutic technique to get him to, you know. No, it was just an elementary mistake. And I was embarrassed. So I go out, and the kid, I don't know why he stayed in the office, but he did. I go out in the waiting room. I said, look, I apologize. That was totally uncalled for. I was out of line. I made a mistake. Would you please forgive me? I wouldn't blame you if you never came back to darken this door again, but I want to let you know that wasn't about you. That was about me. I made a mistake, and I'm sorry. I'll be here if you want to come back, but I'd understand if you didn't. So I left it at that, and they left. The next day, I still felt bad about it, so I sent him a card just to reemphasize. And then he came back. He came back for 4 or 5 more sessions, and then they eventually moved. You know, I can't remember whether or not this kid got much better, but I do remember I learned a lot from that. So I made a mistake. I did my best to reconcile, and guess what? We're all human, and we're going to do that from time to time. So I share that as a learning, and I've been doing therapy for 30 years at the time this happened. You know, it was just a bad day for me. All right. Engagement traps to avoid. Assessment. Now, there's nothing wrong with assessment, but it can interrupt the engagement process. It's not something you have to do to engage, but be careful how you do it. The expert trap, that's I'm the expert here, I know what you need to do. And one of the things that I really appreciated about what Bill Miller said in this little video clip that you saw is he said, you have what you need, and together we're going to find it. So it's not about me being the expert. Now, sometimes you'll get people coming in and saying they want you to be the expert. They're going to put all the responsibility on whether anything changes on your shoulders. And so we have a discussion about that. Premature focus. Anyone know what that means? We've talked about it already. We didn't call it this, but we talked about it. It's if you're at a later stage of change than the patient is or the client is. Like if you're giving them action-oriented assignments and they're still in the contemplation stage, you're not going to get anywhere. And you can see that in your interactions with people in day-to-day. I mean, outside of a therapy setting, sometimes we're talking to people about things that are going on in their lives and we're suggesting things. And what happens is, you know, they get frustrated because they begin to think, well, I'm telling them what to do, which means that I'm assuming they're stupid or incompetent. You see that little trap again? Labeling, we all know about, you know, we have to use diagnostic labels, but they're not to label the essence of a person. I remember working in medical settings years ago, and I would hear nurses and doctors saying, well, it's the appendix in room 304, or it's the fractured tibia in ICU. I mean, it could be anything, you know, and they sort of related to people as the problem rather than people first and then deal with the problem. You know, maybe it works for them. There is a difference between treatment and healing. I think the folks in the behavioral health field do a lot more healing, and people in the mechanistic, physical, medical world do a lot more treatment, and I think there's a necessary place for both. So there's nothing wrong with either one of them. They're just different. Of course, blaming, that's you want to avoid that. Dr. Miller talked about a non-judgmental stance. And it's not chat therapy. I see clients sometimes, and I'm not down on anybody else's work with people, but they have been to 2 or 3 other people in the past, or maybe they've been to agencies, and they'll have panic disorder, and I start thinking, well, what did you all do to help you? And sometimes these people, they don't have the coping skills. You know, they haven't learned diaphragmatic breathing. They haven't learned how to cognitively restructure their anxiety-provoking thoughts, or they haven't learned any basic relaxation procedures to help reduce autonomic arousal. And I'm always fascinated by that. And I think, well, what are they doing? And you start talking to them, they just chatted. Now, there are times when you're doing an engagement that chatting with somebody might be okay, but that shouldn't be the primary focus and modus operandi. Focusing. What do you do when you're focusing? What goals for change does this person really have? You keep coming back to that. What do you want? Where are you trying to get? Do I have a different aspiration for change than this person? I'll get a lot of people that are heavy drinkers. And, you know, some of the research is saying some people who are heavy drinkers can learn to manage their drinking. I mean, we don't see very many of them because by the time they get to us, they're way past that ability. But I've had people say, I just want to cut down on my drinking. Now, I don't go back to them and say, well, you got the wrong goal. You shouldn't want to. You should stop. Well, what's going to happen? They're going to leave the office and go, man, I'm glad to be out of there. I'm not going back. They're not going to do it. So you've lost your ability to be helpful. So you go with their goals. Now, what I will do in that situation sometimes is say, let's try a period of controlled drinking. If that doesn't work, are you willing to try not drinking for 90 days or something like that? I mean, you give them an option. Are we working together for a common purpose? Does it feel like we're moving together, not in different directions? I have this with my girlfriend sometimes. She and I are in sync most of the time, but every once in a while, the way she thinks about the world, she'll say something to me, and I think she means one thing, only to discover later on that she meant something totally different, and then we have a good laugh about it. And I said, she goes, that's what you thought? And I go, well, yeah, it makes perfect sense to me. So sometimes you have to talk more to sync things up. Do I have a clear sense of where we're going? Oftentimes when we get caught up in the minutia of the process of change with people, we do kind of stray from the goal. You forget, okay, now where were we going with all this? Because it's easy to take these little side trails out and investigate certain things, but as soon as you become aware, just bring it back. Does this feel more like dancing or wrestling? We talked about that earlier. Evoking, what are this person's reasons for change? And there are questions you can ask for, you know, let's say the person's smoking cigarettes and they are thinking about stopping. What are some good reasons for changing? If you were to decide to change, what are some good reasons? And they're going to give you those reasons. Is the reluctance more about confidence or important to change? Sometimes you'll hear people say that, and there's I can't remember which book it's in, but in my materials, if anybody wants it, I'll send it to them. But there's a importance and confidence graph that you use. I think it might be in here, and if we have time, I'll get through the slides and show you what it looks like. Because sometimes people aren't changing, not because they don't want to. It's because sometimes they don't think they can, which is an issue of confidence, or it hasn't become important enough. If you have low confidence, you build their confidence. You build their self-efficacy. You affirm things you hear them saying. Well, you know what? You've had other struggles. Remember when you did X and you didn't think you could do that? Well, you learned how to. I remember when I was learning to swim, I'd run up to the edge of the pool and stop, and I'd get scared, and I'd come back, and I'd run up again, and I'd stop. You know, there's this approach avoidance kind of thing. So people have those, and so that was, for me, a lack of confidence. It was important for me to want to learn how to swim because I wanted to be able to play in the pool with my buddies, and I eventually did. What change am I hearing? Listen for change talk. Am I steering too far or too fast in a particular direction? When we get what we used to call resistance, okay, here again, we're converting that to discord. Discord just means there's a disharmony in the dance. You know, somebody's leading too much, somebody's leaning too far the other direction. You just become aware of that and adjust and compensate for it. Doesn't mean you're a bad therapist. It just means pay attention to that. Oftentimes, if you get people being very reactive, then we might be going too fast or too far. Is the writing reflex pulling me to arguing for change? In motivational interviewing, we want the patient or the client to argue for change, not us. And I had a situation, what is today, Friday? I think it was Monday. I was like two statements into something in a session, and I'm going, whoops. I was kind of saying, well, here's a good reason for you to change. We care about people. We want them to be better. But you have to understand the change process doesn't come from without. So planning, what would be a reasonable next step? I'll say to people all the time, Have you thought about what you want to do next? And they'll start talking. Or I'll say, what's your inclination about this? Sometimes you think somebody's ready to start planning, and you say, well, what's your inclination? And they'll back up and go back to contemplation and talk about things. Well, you just roll with that. What would help this person to move forward? Am I remembering to evoke rather than prescribe a plan? Am I offering needed information or advice with permission? So in MI, if you give advice, you do it with permission. You ask people, would it be okay if I give you some feedback about that? Or, I have some information you might not be aware of. Would you like to hear it? Would it be helpful to you if I share what other people who've had this same problem have done that helped them? Do you hear the flavor of doing that? Am I retaining a sense of quiet curiosity about what will work best with this person? Now, having been in this field for a long, long time, one of the things that has helped me to keep from burning out is motivational interviewing, because now I look at each, not just each person, but each session with a person as this adventure and curiosity. I'm truly finding out, what is this person's frame of reference? How do they think about things? And sometimes it's so far afield from the way we think about it, but we haven't had their experience. We haven't walked in their shoes. And sometimes I'm astounded by some of the creative responses people will come up with I never would have thought of suggesting. So it becomes this kind of adventure you're taking with this person, and you're curious about it. But you start to learn their frame of reference and respond to that in appropriate ways. This is the old model, and I like to show people this because there is a value of looking for how to build motivation for change. But it used to seem like this distinct, you got to do phase one stuff and then phase two. Well, no, sometimes that stuff intermingles, okay? Some opening strategies, oars, and we're going to talk about oars because that's one of the basic strategies for helping move people through. Agenda setting, we did a little bit with what we did early on. Scaling questions, I talked about the scale. Decrease resistance, this would be decreasing discord. And then different types of reflections you can use. And then other ways to get people to respond to their own change talk. Evoking change talk, there's some ways you can do that. Here's some other ways. Here's darn cat. Now, if you'll see, you look for desire language. If people are expressing a desire to change, if they start talking about their abilities to change, and sometimes that'll be in the form of, I'm not sure I can do that. Well, it's an ability statement, so you work on, well, what would keep you from being able to, and how might you circumvent that, or how might you compensate for that? You listen for people's reasons and need to change. That's the darn part. Commitment, now, it's changed since this slide was done. It's now called commitment activation and taking steps. So you have darn cat. I like these little acronyms for things. Whoops. Responding to change talk, here's another acronym. You elaborate, affirm, reflect, and summarize. We're not going to get through all these, but we'll work with oars here soon. Any questions about this? This just kind of gives you some idea about the micro skills that are involved in implementing motivational interviewing. It seems really, really complicated, but once you understand each of these, you begin to learn how to kind of sew them in a naturalistic way to what you're doing. In the beginning, it is hard. I remember I had to keep thinking, what, oars, that's open-ended, affirmations. And then stage two, or phase two, is about strengthening commitment to change. Phase one in the old model was about why you should change. It's helping people understand, you know, their own reasons for change. And then this was how you do it, okay? But these things are here again can be interspersed throughout the whole process. Provide information and advice with permission. May I offer some possibilities or options? Are you interested in some suggestions? Are you open to other considerations? Would a review of other options be helpful? And are you looking for helpful information? Sometimes I'll get funny, some people that are funny, I'll say, are you open for advice? And they go, well, duh, what do you think I'm here for? You know? So I'm just trying to be conscientious here. So you help them negotiate a change plan. And if you'll look in your handouts, there's an example of what a change plan looks like, or at least a model you can use. I think this is a blank one. Did I give you that? Well, maybe I didn't. Oh, here it is. It was stuck to the back of this page. Yeah, it looks like this. So what you want to do in getting, once you get to that point, is the changes I want to make or continue making. So we're talking about maintaining or sustaining the change. The reasons why I want to make these changes. The steps I plan to take. The ways other people can help me are. I know that my plan is working if. So this is helpful in terms of outcomes and goals. Some things that could interfere with my plan, what could I do to remedy these? See, that's built in. So if people stumble and they have a setback, or they relapse, to use the old term, you've built that in already to take a look at that. You're saying that's a possibility, so don't give up. It's a part of your change plan. What do I do if the plan's not working? It's another aspect of that same issue. Some helpful hints. Two reflections per each question. And the difference between reflections and questions are, a question tends to go up at the end, and a reflection stays relatively level. And we'll see about that in a few minutes. You're constantly asking yourself, are you wrestling or dancing? Expressing accurate empathy is an accurate reflection of the client's meaning. And sometimes I will say, do you mean by that? And then I'll reflect what I think they mean. It's hypothesis testing. I don't really know what they mean until they confirm. Does that make sense? So you're constantly hypothesis testing, and as soon as they say, okay, you're with me, you got it, then you move on. If not, I stay with it until I got a better understanding. Avoid questions or comments that elicit resistance. And we're all going to do this from time to time. We say goofy things like, that's the biggest bunch of BS I ever heard. And when you talk about eliciting resistance, I mean, that was just, I wish I had a video of that. Reduce discord, okay, right here, evoke change talk. Stabilize the changes. This is just an old saying. Here's an exercise that you can do that's good for training people in the spirit of motivational interviewing. You ask people to elicit their least favorite teacher, for example. And what are the characteristics? What made this person not so good to work with or to be around? And you get things like they're arrogant, or they're bossy, or they're hostile, or they're judgmental, or they're demanding, domineering. You get all this thing. And the favorite part is actually the opposite of some of those things. So we want to elicit more of this kind of thing. People will say, what are some of the characteristics of your favorite coach, or your favorite Sunday school teacher, or your favorite minister, or your favorite parent or friend? And a lot of times you'll hear things like, they're honest, they're open, they're supportive, they're, what are some others they could be? Favorite person. They're curious.
Trustworthy.
Funny. Okay, all those things. So, more spirit of motivational interviewing. So, motivational interviewing facilitates change by reducing discord, raising discrepancy. Now, someone mentioned that earlier. Does anyone know what discrepancy means in MI?
The gap between what you're doing and what you say you want to do.
Excellent. Do you hear that? The gap between where you are, what you're doing, and where you say you want to go, the goal. And that's discrepancy. And sometimes raising discrepancy means you say you want to stop drinking, but one of the things I've noticed in what you've been telling me is you're still hanging around with the same guys in the same place. You're still going to the bars on Friday night. And I'm not so sure how that's going to help you. So it gives this person this sense of, my gosh, what I'm doing is not consistent with where I said I wanted to go. What does that do? Typically, it motivates a person to move toward the goal. Not always, but it's one way. Eliciting change talk, we're going to talk about that. It's responding to change talk, creating a change plan, and sustaining the change. So that's a summary of exactly what motivational interviewing is set up to do. Okay, this is just stuff from we've already talked about. Well, here's one. It's client-centered directive method for enhancing intrinsic motivation. That's the definition out of the earliest text. That's 2002. That's MI1. MI2. Changes from within, not imposed. Makes client responsible. It avoids direct persuasion. It's interactive and guiding. That word should be guiding because that changed in addition to. Resolves ambivalence and works through therapeutic partnership. In other words, it's the relationship between the two people that does the healing. It encourages empathy, maintain congruence. In other words, you got to be real with the people because they'll see right through it if you aren't. Promotes collaborative spirit. Anybody ever call places like the cable company and you're trying to get something from somebody and you can tell all they're doing is reading off of this computer script and it's like you want to go, is there a human on the other end of this line? So that doesn't work very well in therapy. It's collaborative. Recognize that ambivalence is normal. It's not an enemy you want to fight. It's something you want to recognize and work with, work through, help the patient or the client work through it. Resistance can be altered or discord can be altered. If you see it, that's information. It's not a sign that you're doing something wrong or bad. And it supports self-efficacy. Ways to express empathy is through acceptance, skillful reflective listening, and dealing with ambivalence. Welcome aboard. I'll show you to your desk, and someone will be along later to criticize you. Being empathic is to perceive the internal frame of reference of another, Carl Rogers. Components of empathy, there's cognitive types, there's affective types, there's behavioral types. I have a good little video about this. It's only about 3 minutes long, but we're not going to have time to do it today. So empathy is different than detachment. Detachment's sort of an impartial disinterest, you know. And sympathy is actually maybe overly identifying with the person's dilemma. You know, it's a natural part of human, and it's okay to have some sympathy, but it's not the same as empathy. Empathy is communicating that person's meaning, is understanding where they're coming from. Sympathy is not so secret sauce that expedites therapeutic rapport, boosts client satisfaction. That should say improves treatment efficiency or increases treatment efficiency, improves treatment outcomes, and reduces practitioner stress. Pay attention to that. Reduces practitioner stress. Strategies for conveying empathy, are there different types? There's nonverbal, stance, and verbal. In other words, it's how we present to them our nonverbal signs and then verbal things that we say. Developing discrepancy. The client presents argument for change. Discrepancy is the difference between present behavior and future goals, and you want to exaggerate discrepancy sometimes. You don't have to do this in an unkind way. We can be assertive about it. I said, I don't know if you're aware, but sometimes you'll say this, which seems contrary to what you told me last week, was your goal. So this is, are your current behaviors leading toward or away from your stated goals and values? Status quo talk is sustained talk, no change. That should be discord. Here again, I didn't get those corrected in my slides. Goals, commitment language, behavior changes, motivation. This should be rolling with discord, or there, some people call this dancing with discord. Avoid arguing for change. Whoops. Avoid direct opposition. Invite new perspectives, do not impose. Clients responsible for finding solutions, and resistance as a signal, or discord as a signal to respond differently. Supporting self-efficacy, it's that client's belief in their ability to do things and succeed and achieve things. Reinforce that frequently. The individual's responsible for change. Provider's view of the client's self-efficacy affects the outcome. Traps to avoid, question, answer, taking sides, expert, we talked about that a little bit earlier. I'm going to skip forward to ORS so you get a chance to. There's a real fun exercise using roadblocks, but because I know this was only supposed to be a two-hour presentation, right? Here's what ORS stands for: open-ended questions, affirming, reflective listening. And you have a sheet there that you can use to practice applying ORS in therapy sessions. And I had a little 3x5 card on the table next to my chair where I do conduct counseling and therapy. And that was a reminder that what these were for. And it just, it actually was made up of this. And I would look down occasionally and try to intersperse that. And that's one of the ways I learned. And it sped up my learning fairly quickly. Open-ended questions are questions that have more than a one-word answer. You're asking the person to elaborate. There's some samples of closed questions. And is this an open or closed question? What do you think about your current situation? Would that be considered open or closed? Open, yes. Is this strategy effective, open or closed? Closed, so they're going to say yes or no. Let's skip down to what are the most important reasons for making these changes, open or closed? Open, yes. Okay, more examples. You want to stimulate elaboration, ask for more than one word responses. What would you be doing differently if you had already made the change you're considering? That's a handy question. Listen to that. What's that going to say? They're going to start giving you change talk, and they're going to hear themselves saying words about what is possible. If that weren't possible, they wouldn't be thinking of it. So you're moving in a direction of change just by eliciting that. Affirming, accentuate the positive, recognize and acknowledge the good. You know, you showed up today. That's a step in the right direction. You use positive regard and respect. What you say, think, and feel matters. Affirm our you statements versus I statements. Using compliments and statements of appreciation and understanding, that's affirm and support. You want these to be authentic. You don't want to say, I just love that purse. I appreciate your willingness to discuss. If you see somebody is having a painful, difficult time talking about something, I think one way to affirm them in that is to say, I know this is difficult for you, but I appreciate your willingness to take a look at it because I think ultimately it's going to help you. And then here are core skills. So that's one of my favorite slides of this whole thing. Takes a minute, doesn't it? Okay. I see people are getting ready to leave. We're getting ready to wind up. I do appreciate your attention. Anyone have any questions, concerns, comments? What I would suggest, and this is where I was hoping that we'd get to today, and we kind of rushed the end of this here a little bit, but it's in the interest of time and trying to respect your all's schedule, is take the or sheet and set it next to your desk or make a little 3x5 card of what's there and just practice weaving these into the work that you're doing. Also, I have some, and there's a reference list, a resource list that I've given you in the handouts if you want to learn more about motivational interviewing. There's some examples of books written. One is about the stages of change, and the rest of these are about motivational interviewing. Now, let's quickly go through the post-test. And for those of you who have a few minutes, go ahead and respond to these questions, and then I'll ask you a few questions about that. Remember this that we took at the beginning of the training? Anyone need to leave? I totally understand. Thank you for being here. Enjoy your day. Pardon? Yeah, if you want to leave the evaluation on your table, I'll just pick them up on the way out. I don't know if Darlene had one for you to do. Let's just take a couple of these. Bye, Lois. Thank you for your help. Let's just take a couple of these randomly and go down to number 3 where it says establishing the spirit for motivating change. Did anybody have an increase in their understanding of that in the post answers? Anyone have a difference between their pre-answer and their post-answer on that one? Okay, good. Let's see, we didn't get to some of these, so it wouldn't be fair to ask you about them. Assessing stages of change is obviously something that we got to spend a great deal of time with. All right. Questions, concerns, comments?
All those books,
I have one of the initial earlier ones.
Yes.
Do you have one that you recommend more? Because it sounds like the later version, they're trying to make it more than just substance abuse and kind of broaden it.
Oh, yeah. So
this has been the terminology.
This has been applied to a lot of areas outside of substance abuse. This one and this one, health behavior change. This is more about outside the field of substance abuse. So there's motivational interviewing textbook, third edition, and then health behavior change by Rollnick, Mason, and Butler. Thank you guys for your time and attention.